THE MAN FROM ARCHANGEL by Sir Arthur Conan Doyle. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Recording by Lynn Thompson. The Man from Archangel. On the 4th day of March, in the year 1867, I being at that time in my 25th year, I wrote down the following words in my notebook, the result of much mental perturbation and conflict. The solar system, amidst the countless number of other systems as large as itself, rolls ever so silently through space in the direction of the constellation of Hercules. The great spheres of which it is composed spin and spin through the eternal void, ceaselessly and noiselessly. Of these, one of the smallest and most insignificant is that conglomeration of solid and of liquid particles which we have named the Earth. It whirls onwards now, as it has done before my birth, and will do after my death, a revolving mystery, coming none know whence and going none know whither. Upon the outer crust of this moving mass crawl many mites, of whom I, John McVitie, am one, helpless, impotent, being dragged aimlessly through space. Yet such is the state of things amongst us, that the little energy and glimmering of reason which I possess is entirely taken up with the labours which are necessary in order to procure certain metallic discs, wherewith I may purchase the chemical elements necessary to build up my ever-wasting tissues, and keep a roof over me to shelter me from the inclemency of the weather. I thus have no thought to expend upon the vital questions which surround me on every side. Yet, miserable entity as I am, I can still at times feel some degree of happiness, and am even, save the mark, puffed up occasionally with a sense of my own importance. These words, as I have said, I wrote down in my notebook, and they reflected accurately the thoughts which I found rooted far down in my soul, ever present and unaffected by the passing emotions of the hour. At last, however, came a time when my uncle McVitie of Glencairn died, the same who was at one time chairman of committees of the House of Commons. He divided his great wealth among his many nephews, and I found myself with sufficient to provide amply for my wants during the remainder of my life, and became at the same time the owner of a bleak tract of land upon the coast of Caithness, which I think the old man must have bestowed upon me in derision, for it was sandy and valueless, and he had ever a grim sense of humour. Up to this time I had been an attorney in a midland town in England. Now I saw that I could put my thoughts into effect, and, leaving all petty and sordid aims, could elevate my mind by the study of the secrets of nature. My departure from my English home was somewhat accelerated by the fact that I had nearly slain a man in a quarrel, for my temper was fiery, and I was apt to forget my own strength when enraged. There was no legal action taken in the matter, but the papers yelped at me, and folk looked askance when I met them. It ended by my cursing them and their vile, smoke-polluted town, and hurrying to my northern possession, where I might at last find peace and an opportunity for solitary study and contemplation. I borrowed from my capital before I went, and so was able to take with me a choice collection of the most modern philosophical instruments and books, together with chemicals and such other things as I might need in my retirement. The land which I had inherited was a narrow strip consisting mostly of sand, and extending for rather over 2 miles round the coast of Mansea Bay in Caithness. Upon this strip there had been a rambling grey stone building, when erected, or wherefore, none could tell me, and this I had repaired, so that it made a dwelling quite good enough for one of my simple tastes. One room was my laboratory, another my sitting-room, and in a third, just under the sloping roof, I slung the hammock in which I always slept. There were 3 other rooms, but I left them vacant, except one which was given over to the old crone who kept house for me. Save the Youngs and the MacLeods, who were fisher folk, living round at the other side of Fergus Ness, there were no other people for many miles in each direction. In front of the house was the great bay, behind it were two long barren hills, capped by other loftier ones beyond. There was a glen between the hills, and when the wind was from the land, it used to sweep down this with a melancholy sough, and whisper among the branches of the fir-trees beneath my attic window. I dislike my fellow-mortals. Justice compels me to add that they appear for the most part to dislike me. I hate their little crawling ways, their conventionalities, their deceits, their narrow rights and wrongs. They take offence at my brusque outspokenness, my disregard for their social laws, my impatience of all constraint. Among my books and my drugs in my lonely den at Mansi, I could let the great drove of the human race pass onwards with their politics and inventions and tittle-tattle, and I remained behind, stagnant and happy. Not stagnant either, for I was working in my own little groove and making progress. I have reason to believe that Dalton's atomic theory is founded upon error, and I know that mercury is not an element. During the day, I was busy with my distillations and analyses. Often I forgot my meals, and when old Madge summoned me to my tea, I found my dinner lying untouched upon the table. At night I read Bacon, Descartes, Spinoza, Kant, all those who have pried into what is unknowable. They are all fruitless and empty, barren of result, but prodigal of polysyllables, reminding me of men who, while digging for gold, have turned up many worms, and then exhibit them exultantly as being what they sought. At times a restless spirit would come upon me, and I would walk 30 or 40 miles without rest or breaking fast. On these occasions, when I used to stalk through the country villages, gaunt, unshaven, and dishevelled, the mothers would rush into the road and drag their children indoors, and the rustics would swarm out of their pot-houses to gaze at me. I believe that I was known far and wide as the mad Laird of Mansi. It was rarely, however, that I made these raids into the country, for I usually took my exercise upon my own beach, where I soothed my spirit with strong black tobacco, and made the ocean my friend and my confidant. What companion is there like the great restless throbbing sea? What human mood is there which it does not match and sympathize with? There are none so gay but that they may feel gayer when they listen to its merry turmoil, and see the long green surges racing in, with the glint of the sunbeams in their sparkling crests. But when the grey waves toss their heads in anger, and the wind screams above them, goading them on to madder and more tumultuous efforts, then the darkest-minded of men feels that there is a melancholy principle in nature, which is as gloomy as his own thoughts. When it was calm in the Bay of Mansi, the surface would be as clear and bright as a sheet of silver, broken only at one spot some little way from the shore, where a long black line projected out of the water, looking like the jagged back of some sleeping monster. This was the top of the dangerous ridge of rocks known to the fishermen as Ragged Reef of Mansi. When the wind blew from the east, the waves would break upon it like thunder, and the spray would be tossed far over my house and up to the hills behind. The bay itself was a bold and noble one, but too much exposed to the northern and eastern gales, and too much dreaded for its reef, to be much used by mariners. There was something of romance about this lonely spot. I have lain in my boat upon a calm day, and peering over the edge I have seen far down the flickering ghostly forms of great fish, fish, as it seemed to me, such as a naturalist never knew, and which my imagination transformed into the genii of that desolate bay. Once, as I stood by the brink of the waters upon a quiet night, a great cry, as of a woman in hopeless grief, rose from the bosom of the deep, and swelled out upon the still air, now sinking and now rising, for a space of 30 seconds. This I heard with my own ears. In this strange spot, with the eternal hills behind me and the eternal sea in front, I worked and brooded for more than 2 years, unpestered by my fellow men. By degrees I had trained my old servant into habits of silence, so that now she rarely opened her lips, though I doubt not that when twice a year she visited her relations in Wick, her tongue during those few days made up for its enforced rest. I had come almost to forget that I was a member of the human family, and to live entirely with the dead whose books I pored over, when a sudden incident occurred which threw all my thoughts into a new channel. 3 rough days in June had been succeeded by one calm and peaceful one. There was not a breath of air that evening. The sun sank down in the west behind a line of purple clouds, and the smooth surface of the bay was gashed with scarlet streaks. Along the beach the pools left by the tide showed up like gouts of blood against the yellow sand, as if some wounded giant had toilfully passed that way, and had left these red traces of his grievous hurt behind him. As the darkness closed in, certain ragged clouds which had lain low on the eastern horizon coalesced and formed a great irregular cumulus. The glass was still low, and I knew that there was mischief brewing. About 9 o'clock a dull moaning sound came up from the sea, as from a creature who, much harassed, learns that the hour of suffering has come round again. At 10 a sharp breeze sprang up from the eastward. At 11 it had increased to a gale, and by midnight the most furious storm was raging which I ever remember upon that weather-beaten coast. As I went to bed, the shingle and seaweed were pattering up against my attic window, and the wind was screaming as though every gust were a lost soul. By that time the sounds of the tempest had become a lullaby to me. I knew that the grey walls of the old house would buffet it out, and for what occurred in the world outside I had small concern. Old Madge was usually as callous to such things as I was myself. It was a surprise to me when, about 3 in the morning, I was awoke by the sound of a great knocking at my door and excited cries in the wheezy voice of my housekeeper. I sprang out of my hammock and roughly demanded of her what was the matter. "Eh, maester, maester!" she screamed in her hateful dialect. "Come doon, man, come doon! There's a muckle ship gone ashore on the reef, and poor folks are yammering and crying for help, and I doot they be adroon. Oh, maester Mavitti, come doon!" "Hold your tongue, you hag," I shouted back in passion. "What is it to you whether they are drowned or not? Get back to your bed and leave me alone." I turned in again and drew the blankets over me. "Those men out there," I said to myself, "have already gone through half the horrors of death. If they be saved, they will but have to go through the same once more in the space of a few brief years. It is best, therefore, that they should pass away now, since they have suffered that anticipation which is more than the pain of dissolution." With this thought in my mind, I endeavoured to compose myself to sleep once more, for that philosophy which had taught me to consider death as a small and trivial incident in man's eternal and ever-changing career had also broken me of much curiosity concerning worldly matters. On this occasion I found, however, that the old leaven still fermented strongly in my soul. I tossed from side to side for some minutes, endeavouring to beat down the impulses of the moment by the rules of conduct which I had framed during months of thought. Then I heard a dull roar amid the wild shriek of the gale, and I knew that it was the sound of a signal gun. Driven by an uncontrollable impulse, I rose, dressed, and having lit my pipe, walked out onto the beach. It was pitch dark when I came outside, and the wind blew with such violence that I had to put my shoulder against it and push my way along the shingle. My face pringled and smarted with the sting of the gravel which was blown against it, and the red ashes of my pipe streamed away behind me, dancing fantastically through the darkness. I went down to where the great waves were thundering in, and shading my eyes with my hands to keep off the salt spray, I peered out to sea. I could distinguish nothing, and yet it seemed to me that shouts and great inarticulate cries were borne to me by the blasts. Suddenly, as I gazed, I made out the glint of a light, and then the whole bay and the beach were lit up in a moment by a vivid blue glare. They were burning a coloured signal light on board of the vessel. There she lay on her beam ends, right in the centre of the jagged reef, hurled over to such an angle that I could see all the planking of her deck. She was a large two-masted schooner of foreign rig, and lay perhaps 180 or 200 yards from the shore. Every spar and rope and writhing piece of cordage showed up hard and clear under the livid light which sputtered and flickered from the highest portion of the forecastle. Beyond the doomed ship, out of the great darkness, came the long rolling lines of black waves, never ending, never tiring, with a petulant tuft of foam here and there upon their crests. Each, as it reached the broad circle of unnatural light, appeared to gather strength and volume, and to hurry on more impetuously until, with a roar and a jarring crash, it sprang upon its victim. Clinging to the weather shrouds, I could distinctly see some 10 or 12 frightened seamen, who, when their light revealed my presence, turned their white faces towards me and waved their hands imploringly. I felt my gorge rise against these poor cowering worms. Why should they presume to shirk the narrow pathway along which all that is great and noble among mankind has travelled? There was one there who interested me more than they. He was a tall man who stood apart from the others, balancing himself upon the swaying wreck as though he disdained to cling to rope or bulwark. His hands were clasped behind his back, and his head was sunk upon his breast, but even in that despondent attitude there was a litheness and decision in his pose and in every motion which marked him as a man little likely to yield to despair. Indeed, I could see by his occasional rapid glances up and down and all around him that he was weighing every chance of safety, but though he often gazed across the raging surf to where he could see my dark figure upon the beach, his self-respect, or some other reason, forbade him from imploring my help in any way. He stood dark, silent, and inscrutable, looking down on the black sea, and waiting for whatever fortune fate might send him. It seemed to me that the problem would very soon be settled. As I looked, an enormous billow topping all the others, and coming after them, like a driver following a flock, swept over the vessel. Her foremast snapped short off, and the men who clung to the shrouds were brushed away like a swarm of flies. With a rending, riving sound, the ship began to split in two, where the sharp back of the Mansi reef was soaring into her keel. The solitary man upon the forecastle ran rapidly across the deck and seized hold of a white bundle, which I had already observed but failed to make out. As he lifted it up, the light fell upon it, and I saw that the object was a woman, with a spar lashed across her body and under her arms in such a way that her head should always rise above water. He bore her tenderly to the side, and seemed to speak for a minute or so to her, as though explaining the impossibility of remaining upon the ship. Her answer was a singular one. I saw her deliberately raise her hand and strike him across the face with it. He appeared to be silenced for a moment or so by this, but he addressed her again, directing her, as far as I could gather from his motions, how she should behave when in the water. She shrank away from him, but he caught her in his arms. He stood over her for a moment and seemed to press his lips against her forehead. Then a great wave came welling up against the side of the breaking vessel, and leaning over, he placed her upon the summit of it as gently as a child might be committed to its cradle. I saw her white dress flickering among the foam on the crest of the dark billow, and then the light sank gradually lower, and the riven ship and its lonely occupant were hidden from my eyes. As I watched those things, my manhood overcame my philosophy, and I felt a frantic impulse to be up and doing. I threw my cynicism to one side as a garment which I might don again at leisure, and I rushed wildly to my boat and my sculls. She was a leaky tub, but what then? Was I, who had cast many a wistful, doubtful glance at my opium-bottle, to begin now to weigh chances and to cavil at danger? I dragged her down to the sea with the strength of a maniac, and sprang in. For a moment or two it was a question whether she could live among the boiling surge, but a dozen frantic strokes took me through it, half full of water, but still afloat. I was out on the unbroken waves now, at one time climbing up in the broad black breast of one, then sinking down on the other side, until, looking up, I could see the gleam of the foam all around me against the dark heavens. Far behind me I could hear the wild wailings of old Madge, who, seeing me start, thought no doubt that my madness had come to a climax. As I rowed, I peered over my shoulder, until at last on the belly of a great wave which was sweeping towards me I distinguished the vague white outline of the woman. Stooping over, I seized her as she swept by me, and with an effort lifted her, all sodden with water, into the boat. There was no need to row back, for the next billow carried us in and threw us upon the beach. I dragged the boat out of danger, and then, lifting up the woman, I carried her to the house, followed by my housekeeper, loud with congratulation and praise. Now that I had done this thing, a reaction set in upon me. I felt that my burden lived, for I heard the faint beat of her heart as I pressed my ear against her side in carrying her. Knowing this, I threw her down beside the fire which Madge had lit, with as little sympathy as though she had been a bundle of faggots. I never glanced at her to see if she were fair or no. For many years I had cared little for the face of a woman. As I lay in my hammock upstairs, however, I heard the old woman, as she chafed the warmth back into her, crooning a chorus of, "Eh, the poor lassie! Eh, the bonny lassie!" from which I gathered that this piece of jetsam was both young and comely. The morning after the gale was peaceful and sunny. As I walked along the long sweep of sand, I could hear the panting of the sea. It was heaving and swirling about the reef, but along the shore it rippled in gently enough. There was no sign of the schooner, nor was there any wreckage upon the beach, which did not surprise me, as I knew there was a great undertow in those waters. A couple of broad-winged gulls were hovering and skimming over the scene of the shipwreck, as though many strange things were visible to them beneath the waves. At times I could hear their raucous voices as they spoke to one another of what they saw. When I came back from my walk, the woman was waiting at the door for me. I began to wish, when I saw her, that I had never saved her, for here was an end of my privacy. She was very young, at most 19, with a pale, somewhat refined face, yellow hair, merry blue eyes, and shining teeth. Her beauty was of an ethereal type. She looked so white and light and fragile that she might have been the spirit of that storm foam from out of which I plucked her. She had wreathed some of Madge's garments round her in a way which was quaint and not unbecoming. As I strode heavily up the pathway, she put out her hands with a pretty, childlike gesture, and ran down towards me, meaning, as I surmised, to thank me for having saved her. But I put her aside with a wave of my hand, and passed her. At this she seemed somewhat hurt, and the tears sprang into her eyes, but she followed me into the sitting-room, and watched me wistfully. "What country do you come from?" I asked her suddenly. She smiled when I spoke, but shook her head. "Francais?" I asked. "Deutsch? Espagnol?" Each time she shook her head, and then she rippled off into a long statement, in some tongue of which I could not understand one word. After breakfast was over, however, I got a clue to her nationality. Passing along the beach once more, I saw that in a cleft of the ridge a piece of wood had been jammed. I rowed out to it in my boat and brought it ashore. It was part of the stern-post of a boat, and on it, or rather on the piece of wood attached to it, was the word Archangel, painted in strange, quaint lettering. "So," I thought as I paddled slowly back, "this pale damsel is a Russian, a fit subject for the White Tsar, and a proper dweller on the shores of the White Sea." It seemed to me strange that one of her apparent refinement should perform so long a journey in so frail a craft. When I came back into the house, I pronounced the word Archangel several times in different intonations, but she did not appear to recognize it. I shut myself up in the laboratory all morning, continuing a research which I was making into the nature of the allotropic forms of carbon and of sulphur. When I came out at midday for some food, she was sitting by the table with a needle and thread, mending some rents in her clothes, which were now dry. I resented her continued presence, but I could not turn her out on the beach to shift for herself. Presently she presented a new phase of her character, pointing to herself and then to the scene of the shipwreck. She held up one finger, by which I understood her to be asking whether she was the only one saved. I nodded my head to indicate that she was. On this she sprang out of her chair with a cry of great joy, and holding the garment which she was mending over her head and swaying it from side to side with the motion of her body, she danced as lightly as a feather all round the room, and then out through the open door into the sunshine. As she whirled round, she sang in a plaintive, shrill voice some uncouth, barbarous chant expressive of exultation. I called out to her, "Come in, you young fiend, come in and be silent," but she went on with her dance. Then she suddenly ran towards me, and catching my hand before I could pluck it away, she kissed it. While we were at dinner, she spied one of my pencils, and taking it up, she wrote the two words, "Sophie Ramusine," upon a piece of paper, and then pointed to herself as a sign that that was her name. She handed the pencil to me, evidently expecting that I would be equally communicative, but I put it in my pocket as a sign that I wished to hold no intercourse with her. Every moment of my life now I regretted the unguarded precipitancy with which I had saved this woman. What was it to me whether she had lived or died? I was no young, hot-headed youth to do such things. It was bad enough to be compelled to have Madge in the house, but she was old and ugly and could be ignored. This one was young and lively, and so fashioned as to divert attention from graver things. Where could I send her, and what could I do with her? If I sent information to Wick, it would mean that officials and others would come to me and pry and peep and chatter, a hateful thought. It was better to endure her presence than that. I soon found that there were fresh troubles in store for me. There is no place safe from the swarming, restless race of which I am a member. In the evening, when the sun was dipping down behind the hills, casting them into dark shadow, but gilding the sands and casting a great glory over the sea, I went, as is my custom, for a stroll along the beach. Sometimes on these occasions I took my book with me. I did so on this night, and stretching myself upon a sand dune, I composed myself to read. As I lay there, I suddenly became aware of a shadow which interposed itself between the sun and myself. Looking round, I saw to my great surprise a very tall, powerful man, who was standing a few yards off, and who, instead of looking at me, was ignoring my existence completely, and was gazing over my head with a stern, set face at the bay and the black line of the Mansi reef. His complexion was dark, with black hair and short curling beard, a hawk-like nose and golden earrings in his ears, the general effect being wild and somewhat noble. He wore a faded velveteen jacket, a red flannel shirt, and high sea-boots coming halfway up his thighs. I recognized him at a glance as being the same man who had been left on the wreck the night before. "Hello," I said in an aggrieved voice, "you got ashore all right, then?" "Yes," he answered in good English. "It was no doing of mine. The waves threw me up. I wish to God I had been allowed to drown." There was a slight foreign lisp in his accent which was rather pleasing. "Two good fishermen who live round yonder point pulled me out and cared for me, yet I could not honestly thank them for it." "Ho-ho," thought I, "here is a man of my own kidney." "Why do you wish to be drowned?" I asked. "Because," he cried, throwing out his long arms with a passionate, despairing gesture, there in that blue, smiling bay lies my soul, my treasure, everything that I loved and lived for." "Well, well," I said, "people are ruined every day, but there's no use making a fuss about it. Let me inform you that this ground on which you walk is my ground, and that the sooner you take yourself off it, the better pleased I shall be. One of you is quite enough trouble." "One of us?" he gasped. "Yes, if you could take her off with you, I should be still more grateful." He gazed at me for a moment as if hardly able to realize what I said, and then, with a great cry, he ran away from me with prodigious speed and raced along the sands towards my house. Never before or since have I seen a human being run so fast. I followed as rapidly as I could, furious at this threatened invasion, but long before I reached the house he had disappeared through the open door. I heard a great scream from the inside, and as I came nearer, the sound of a man's bass voice speaking rapidly and loudly. When I looked in, the girl, Sophie Remusine, was crouching in a corner, cowering away, with fear and loathing expressed on her averted face and in every line of her shrinking form. The other, with his dark eyes flashing and his outstretched hands quivering with emotion, was pouring forth a torrent of passionate, pleading words. He made a step forward to her as I entered, but she writhed still further away, and uttered a sharp cry like that of a rabbit when the weasel has him by the throat. "Here," I said, pulling him back from her. "This is a pretty to-do. What do you mean? Do you think this is a wayside inn or place of public accommodation?" "Oh, sir," he said, "excuse me. This woman is my wife, and I feared that she was drowned. You have brought me back to life." "Who are you?" I asked roughly. "I am a man from Archangel," he said simply, "a Russian man." "What is your name?"
"Organeff."
"Organeff? And hers is Sophie Ramusine. She is no wife of yours. She has no ring." "We are man and wife in the sight of heaven," he said solemnly, looking upwards. "We are bound by higher laws than those of earth." As he spoke, the girl slipped behind me and caught me by the other hand, pressing it as though beseeching my protection. "Give me up my wife, sir," he went on. "Let me take her away from here." "Look here, you, whatever your name is," I said sternly. "I don't want this wench here. I wish I had never seen her. If she died, it would be no grief to me. But as to handing her over to you, when it is clear she fears and hates you, I won't do it. So now just clear your great body out of this, and leave me to my books. I hope I may never look upon your face again." "You won't give her up to me?" he said hoarsely. "I'll see you damned first," I answered. "Suppose I take her," he cried, his dark face growing darker. All my tigerish blood flashed up in a moment. I picked up a little billet of wood from beside the fireplace. "Go," I said in a low voice. "Go quick, or I may do you an injury." He looked at me irresolutely for a moment, and then he left the house. He came back again in a moment, however, and stood in the doorway, looking at us. "Have a heed what you do," he said. "The woman is mine, and I shall have her. When it comes to blows, a Russian is as good a man as a Scotchman." "We shall see that," I cried, springing forward. But he was already gone, and I could see his tall form moving away through the gathering darkness. For a month or more after this, things went smoothly with us. I never spoke to the Russian girl, nor did she ever address me. Sometimes, when I was at work in my laboratory, she would slip inside the door and sit silently there, watching me with her great eyes. At first this intrusion annoyed me, but by degrees, finding that she made no attempt to distract my attention, I suffered her to remain. Encouraged by this concession, she gradually came to move the stool on which she sat nearer and nearer to my table, until after gaining a little every day during some weeks, she at last worked her way right up to me, and used to perch herself beside me whenever I worked. In this position she used, still without ever obtruding her presence in any way, to make herself very useful by holding my pens, test-tubes, or bottles, and handing me whatever I wanted, with never-failing sagacity. By ignoring the fact of her being a human being, and looking upon her as a useful automatic machine, I accustomed myself to her presence so far as to miss her on the few occasions when she was not at her post. I have a habit of talking aloud to myself at times when I work, so as to fix my results better in my mind. The girl must have had a surprising memory for sounds, for she could always repeat the words which I had let fall in this way, without, of course, understanding in the least what they meant. I have often been amused at hearing her discharge a volley of chemical equations and algebraic symbols at old Madge, and then burst into a ringing laugh when the crone would shake her head, under the impression, no doubt, that she was being addressed in Russian. She never went more than a few yards from the house, and indeed never put her foot over the threshold without looking carefully out of each window, in order to be sure that there was nobody about. By this I knew that she suspected that her fellow countryman was still in the neighbourhood, and feared that he might attempt to carry her off. She did something else which was significant. I had an old revolver and some cartridges, which had been thrown away among the rubbish. She found this one day, and at once proceeded to clean it and oil it. She hung it up near the door with the cartridges in a little bag beside it, and whenever I went for a walk, she would take it down and insist upon my carrying it with me. In my absence, she would always bolt the door. Apart from her apprehensions, she seemed fairly happy, busying herself in helping Madge when she was not attending upon me. She was wonderfully nimble-fingered and natty in all domestic duties. It was not long before I discovered that her suspicions were well-founded, and that this man from Archangel was still lurking in the vicinity. Being restless one night, I rose and peered out of the window. The weather was somewhat cloudy, and I could barely make out the line of the sea, and the loom of my boat upon the beach. As I gazed, however, and my eyes became accustomed to the obscurity, I became aware that there was some other dark blur upon the sands, and that in front of my very door, where certainly there had been nothing of the sort the preceding night. As I stood at my diamond-paned lattice, still peering and peeping, to make out what this might be, a great bank of clouds rolled slowly away from the face of the moon, and a flood of cold, clear light was poured down upon the silent bay and the long sweep of its desolate shores. Then I saw what this was which haunted my doorstep. It was he, the Russian. He squatted there like a gigantic toad, with his legs doubled under him in strange Mongolian fashion, and his eyes fixed apparently upon the window of the room in which the young girl and the housekeeper slept. The light fell upon his upturned face, and I saw once more the hawk-like grace of his countenance, with the single, deeply indented line of care upon his brow, and the protruding beard which marks the passionate nature. My first impulse was to shoot him as a trespasser, but as I gazed, my resentment changed into pity and contempt. "Poor fool," I said to myself, "it is then possible that you, whom I have seen looking open-mouthed at present death, should have your whole thoughts and ambitions centred upon this wretched slip of a girl, too, who flies from you and hates you. Most women would love you, were it but for that dark face and great handsome body of yours, and yet you must needs hanker after the one in a thousand who will have no traffic with you." As I returned to my bed, I chuckled much to myself over this thought. I knew that my bars were strong and my bolts thick. It mattered little to me whether this strange man spent his night at my door or 100 leagues off, so long as he was gone by the morning. As I expected, when I rose and went out, there was no sign of him, nor had he left any trace of his midnight vigil. It was not long, however, before I saw him again. I had been out for a row one morning, for my head was aching, partly from prolonged stooping, and partly from the effects of a noxious drug which I had inhaled the night before. I pulled along the coast some miles, and then, feeling thirsty, I landed at a place where I knew that a fresh water stream trickled down into the sea. This rivulet passed through my land, but the mouth of it, where I found myself that day, was beyond my boundary line. I felt somewhat taken aback when, rising from the stream at which I had slaked my thirst, I found myself face to face with the Russian. I was as much a trespasser now as he was, and I could see at a glance that he knew it. "I wish to speak a few words to you," he said gravely. "Hurry up, then," I answered, glancing at my watch. "I have no time to listen to chatter." "Chatter!" he repeated angrily. "Ah, but there, you Scotch people are strange men. Your face is hard, and your words rough, but so are those of the good fishermen with whom I stay. Yet I find that beneath it all there lie kind, honest natures. No doubt you are kind and good, too, in spite of your roughness. "In the name of the devil," I said, "say your say and go your way. I am weary of the sight of you."
"Can I not soften you in any way?" he cried. "Ah, see here." He produced a small Grecian cross from inside his velvet jacket. "Look at this. Our religions may differ in form, but at least we have some common thoughts and feelings when we see this emblem."
"I am not so sure of that," I answered.
He looked at me thoughtfully. "You are a very strange man," he said at last. "I cannot understand you. You still stand between me and Sophie. It is a dangerous position to take, sir. Oh, believe me, before it is too late. If you did but know what I have done to gain that woman, how I have risked my body, how I have lost my soul. You are a small obstacle to some which I have surmounted. You, whom a rip with a knife or a blow from a stone would put out of my way forever. But God preserve me from that," he cried wildly. "I am deep, too deep already. Anything rather than that."
"You would do better to go back to your own country," I said, "than to skulk about these sandhills and disturb my leisure. When I have proof that you have gone away, I shall hand this woman over to the protection of the Russian consul at Edinburgh. Until then, I shall guard her myself, and not you, nor any Muscovite that ever breathed, shall take her from me."
"And what is your object in keeping me from Sophie?" he asked. "Do you imagine that I would injure her? Why, man, I would give my life freely to save her from the slightest harm. Why do you do this thing?"
"I do it because it is my good pleasure to act so," I answered. "I give no man reasons for my conduct."
"Look here," he cried, suddenly blazing into fury, and advancing towards me with his shaggy mane bristling and his brown hands clenched. "If I thought you had one dishonest thought towards this girl, if for a moment I had reason to believe that you had any base motive for detaining her, as sure as there is a God in heaven, I should drag the heart out of your bosom with my hands."
The very idea seemed to have put the man in a frenzy, for his face was all distorted and his hands opened and shut convulsively. I thought that he was about to spring at my throat.
"Stand off," I said, putting my hand on my pistol. "If you lay a finger on me, I shall kill you."
He put his hand into his pocket, and for a moment I thought he was about to produce a weapon too, but instead of that, he whipped out a cigarette and lit it, breathing the smoke rapidly into his lungs. No doubt he had found by experience that this was the most effectual way of curbing his passions.
"I told you," he said in a quieter voice, "that my name is Organeff, Alexis Organeff. I am a Finn by birth, but I have spent my life in every part of the world. I was one who could never be still, nor settle down to a quiet existence. After I came to own my own ship, there is hardly a port from Archangel to Australia which I have not entered. I was rough and wild and free, but there was one at home, sir, who was prim and white-handed and soft-tongued, skilful in little fancies and conceits which women love. This youth, by his wiles and tricks, stole from me the love of the girl whom I had ever marked as my own, and who up to that time had seemed in some sort inclined to return my passion. I had been on a voyage to Hammerfest for ivory, and coming back unexpectedly, I learned that my pride and treasure was to be married to this soft-skinned boy, and that the party had actually gone to the church. In such moments, sir, something gives way in my head, and I hardly know what I do. I landed with a boat's crew, all men who had sailed with me for years, and who were as true as steel. We went up to the church. They were standing, she and he, before the priest, but the thing had not been done. I dashed between them and caught her round the waist. My men beat back the frightened bridegroom and the lookers-on. We bore her down to the boat and aboard our vessel, and then, getting up anchor, we sailed away across the white sea until the spires of Archangel sank down behind the horizon. She had my cabin, my room, every comfort. I slept among the men in the forecastle. I hoped that in time her aversion to me would wear away, and that she would consent to marry me in England or in France. For days and days we sailed. We saw the North Cape die away behind us, and we skirted the grey Norwegian coast, but still, in spite of every attention, she would not forgive me for tearing her from that pale-faced lover of hers. Then came this cursed storm which shattered both my ship and my hopes, and has deprived me even of the sight of the woman for whom I have risked so much. Perhaps she may learn to love me yet. You, sir, he said wistfully, look like one who has seen much of the world. Do you not think that she may come to forget this man and to love me? I am tired of your story, I said, turning away. For my part, I think you are a great fool. If you imagine that this love of yours will pass away, you had best amuse yourself as best you can until it does. If, on the other hand, it is a fixed thing, you cannot do better than cut your throat, for that is the shortest way out of it. I have no more time to waste on the matter. With this I hurried away and walked down to the boat. I never looked round, but I heard the dull sound of his feet upon the sands as he followed me. I have told you the beginning of my story, he said, and you shall know the end some day. You would do well to let the girl go. I never answered him, but pushed the boat off. When I had rowed some distance out, I looked back and saw his tall figure upon the yellow sand as he stood gazing thoughtfully after me. When I looked again some minutes later, he had disappeared. For a long time after this, my life was as regular and as monotonous as it had been before the shipwreck. At times I hoped that the man from Archangel had gone away altogether, but certain footsteps which I saw upon the sand, and more particularly a little pile of cigarette ash which I found one day behind a hillock from which a view of the house might be obtained, warned me that, though invisible, he was still in the vicinity. My relations with the Russian girl remained the same as before. Old Madge had been somewhat jealous of her presence at first, and seemed to fear that what little authority she had would be taken away from her. By degrees, however, as she came to realize my utter indifference, she became reconciled to the situation and, as I have said before, profited by it, as our visitor performed much of the domestic work. And now I am coming near the end of this narrative of mine, which I have written a great deal more for my own amusement than for that of any one else. The termination of the strange episode in which these two Russians had played a part was as wild and as sudden as the commencement. The events of one single night freed me from all my troubles, and left me once more alone with my books and my studies, as I had been before their intrusion. Let me endeavour to describe how this came about. I had had a long day of heavy and wearying work, so that in the evening I determined upon taking a long walk. When I emerged from the house, my attention was attracted by the appearance of the sea. It lay like a sheet of glass, so that never a ripple disturbed its surface. Yet the air was filled with that indescribable moaning sound which I have alluded to before, a sound as though the spirits of all those who lay beneath those treacherous waters were sending a sad warning of coming troubles to their brethren in the flesh. The fishermen's wives along the coast know the eerie sound, and look anxiously across the waters for the brown sails making for the land. When I heard it, I stepped back to the house and looked at the glass. It was down below 29 degrees. Then I knew that a wild night was coming upon us. Underneath the hills where I walked that evening, it was dull and chill, but their summits were rosy red, and the sea was brightened by the sinking sun. There were no clouds of importance in the sky, yet the dull groaning of the sea grew louder and stronger. I saw, far to the eastward, a brig beating up for wick, with a reef in her topsails. It was evident that her captain had read the signs of nature as I had done. Behind her a long, lurid haze lay low upon the water, concealing the horizon. I had better push on, I thought to myself, or the wind may rise before I can get back. I suppose I must have been at least half a mile from the house when I suddenly stopped and listened breathlessly. My ears were so accustomed to the noises of nature, the sighing of the breeze and the sob of the waves, that any other sound made itself heard at a great distance. I waited, listening with all my ears. Yes, there it was again, a long-drawn, shrill cry of despair, ringing over the sands and echoed back from the hills behind me. A piteous appeal for aid. It came from the direction of my house, I turned and ran back homewards at the top of my speed, ploughing through the sand, racing over the shingle. In my mind there was a great dim perception of what had occurred. About a quarter of a mile from the house there is a high sand-hill from which the whole country round is visible. When I reached the top of this, I paused for a moment. There was the old grey building, there the boat. Everything seemed to be as I had left it. Even as I gazed, however, the shrill scream was repeated, louder than before, and the next moment a tall figure emerged from my door, the figure of the Russian sailor. Over his shoulder was the white form of the young girl, and even in his haste he seemed to bear her tenderly and with gentle reverence. I could hear her wild cries and see her desperate struggles to break away from him. Behind the couple came my housekeeper, staunch and true, as the aged dog, who can no longer bite, still snarls with toothless gums at the intruder. She staggered feebly along at the heels of the ravisher, waving her long thin arms and hurling, no doubt, volleys of Scotch curses and imprecations at his head. I saw at a glance that he was making for the boat. A sudden hope sprang up in my mind that I might be in time to intercept him. I ran for the beach at the top of my speed. As I ran, I slipped a cartridge into my revolver. This, I determined, should be the last of these invasions. I was too late. By the time I reached the water's edge, he was 100 yards away, making the boat spring with every stroke of his powerful arms. I uttered a wild cry of impotent anger and stamped up and down the sands like a maniac. He turned and saw me. Rising from his seat, he made me a graceful bow and waved his hand to me. It was not a triumphant or derisive gesture. Even my furious and distempered mind recognized it as being a solemn and courteous leave-taking. Then he settled down to his oars once more, and the little skiff shot away out over the bay. The sun had gone down now, leaving a single dull red streak upon the water, which stretched away until it blended with the purple haze on the horizon. Gradually the skiff grew smaller and smaller as it sped across this lurid band, until the shades of night gathered round it, and it became a mere blur upon the lonely sea. Then this vague gloom died away also, and darkness settled over it, a darkness which should never be raised. And why did I pace the solitary shore, hot and wrathful as a wolf whose whelp had been torn from it? Was it that I loved this Muscovite girl? No, 1,000 times no. I am not one who, for the sake of a white skin or a blue eye, would belie my own life, and change the whole tenor of my thoughts and existence. My heart was untouched, but my pride, ah, there I had been cruelly wounded. To think that I had been unable to afford protection to the helpless one who craved it of me, and who relied on me. It was that which made my heart sick and sent the blood buzzing through my ears. That night a great wind rose up from the sea, and the wild waves shrieked upon the shore as though they would tear it back with them into the ocean. The turmoil and the uproar were congenial to my vexed spirit. All night I wandered up and down, wet with spray and rain, watching the gleam of the white breakers and listening to the outcry of the storm. My heart was bitter against the Russian. I joined my feeble pipe to the screaming of the gale. "If he would but come back again," I cried with clenched hands. "If he would but come back!" He came back. When the light grey of morning spread over the eastern sky and lit up the great waste of yellow, tossing waters, with the brown clouds drifting swiftly over them, then I saw him once again. A few 100 yards off along the sand there lay a long dark object, cast up by the fury of the waves. It was my boat, much shattered and splintered. A little farther on, a vague, shapeless something was washing to and fro in the shallow water, all mixed with shingle and with seaweed. I saw at a glance that it was the Russian, face downward and dead. I rushed into the water and dragged him up onto the beach. It was only when I turned him over that I discovered that she was beneath him, his dead arms encircling her, his mangled body still intervening between her and the fury of the storm. It seemed that the fierce German sea might beat the life from him, but with all its strength it was unable to tear this one-idea'd man from the woman he loved. There were signs which led me to believe that during that awful night the woman's fickle mind had come at last to learn the worth of the true heart and strong arm which struggled for her and guarded her so tenderly. Why else should her little head be nestling so lovingly on his broad breast, while her yellow hair entwined itself with his flowing beard? Why, too, should there be that bright smile of ineffable happiness and triumph which death itself had not the power to banish from his dusky face? I fancy that death had been brighter to him than life had ever been. Madge and I buried them there, on the shores of the desolate northern sea. They lie in one grave, deep down beneath the yellow sand. Strange things may happen in the world around them. Empires may rise and may fall, dynasties may perish, great wars may come and go, but, heedless of it all, those two shall embrace each other for ever and aye, in their lonely shrine by the side of the sounding ocean. I sometimes have thought that their spirits flit like shadowy sea-mews over the wild waters of the bay. No cross or symbol marks their resting-place, but old Madge puts wild flowers upon it at times, and when I pass on my daily walk and see the fresh blossoms scattered over the sand, I think of the strange couple who came from afar and broke for a little space the dull tenor of my sombre life. End of The Man from Archangel by Arthur Conan Doyle.